Now a G be a simple limit. So by simple ligung we mean a ligung with Lie algebra is simple, or if you want, it's a ligung. More or less, it's true to say that it's always a group of matrices. It's true up to isogeny. It's almost true, and so it's a group of matrices such that the only normal there are no normal subgroups, so it's simple as abstract group, or there are no closed normal subgroup, except I allow finite or discrete central subgroups. Like, so example, SLN R is a simple Lie group, but it has a normal subgroup. The center, if n is even, is non-trivial. So for instance, SL2R has a center of two elements, plus minus one. But still we call it a simple Lie group, and we allow central subgroup. If you want, we can divide by this, and then get a really simple, so something we call almost simple. So let's actually say simple. Why almost simple? I don't care that it's a matrix. Another is the group of isometries of the hyperbolic space is sometimes denoted P, O, and 1 for some reasons. It's the same as the group of matrices which preserve a quadratic form of signature N1. By the way, just a remark, these are not completely disjoint families. The PSL2R, as mentioned already, is the same as the group of, is the same as PO2R, 2-1, so it's a group of isometries of the hyperbolic plane. And PSL2C, okay, so here, another example is PSLNC. So PSL2C is the group of isometries of the hyperbolic space. If you look at three-dimensional hyperbolic space, the group of isometries, you can see it as exactly as the group of 2x2 matrices with determinant 1 over the complex.
So, can you say briefly what is a three-dimensional hyperbolic space?
A three-dimensional hyperbolic space is a three-dimensional, the Lobachevsky space is the contractible Riemannian space, actually diffeomorphic to R3, with a Riemannian structure that the curvature is minus 1 at any point. So for instance, if you are familiar with the upper half plane, you can discuss the upper half space. And so this, say x, y, z, and the metric is dx squared plus dy squared plus dz squared divided by z.
And it's the same form with n?
Yes.
Just the last variable divided
yes.
by?
Okay. Another form to view it is to look inside Rn plus 1. We look in Rn plus 1, so it's hard to use a two-dimensional ball to draw four-dimensional space, so let me go back to the two-dimensional space, and inside you have the form 1 1 minus 1 or 1 1, so the form 1 1 and minus 1 at the end, so it's a quadratic form, and you look at it defines, if you want, a billionaire form on Rn, which is not positive definite, so it's not an inner product anymore. But inside, you look at all.
It's called Lorentzian form.
It's called the Lorentz form. It's related to relativity theory. But inside, you look at all the sub-level sets of so you have a quadratic form, and you look at all the points whose value is exactly one or minus one. And then if you restrict the form to this or to the connected half of it, then it becomes a positive definite on the tangent space at any point, and you can conclude that the curvature is minus one, and this is actually another model for the hyperbolic space. Some hint that the isometric group has this notation, but the matrices that preserve this form. But at some point we will discuss different models of the hyperbolic space. There is a unique hyperbolic space in every dimension, and the manifold which are locally, or in which are locally every point of the ball around with the isometric to the ball in the hyperbolic space is a called hyperbolic manifolds, and if you are hyperbolic manifold and you are complete with respect to the remaining structure, then the universal cover is the hyperbolic space. And in fact, you can view the manifold as the hyperbolic space quotient divided by some discrete group action. So there is a correspondence between hyperbolic manifold to discrete groups inside PSL2R. Hyperbolic three-dimensional hyperbolic manifold are in one-to-one correspondence with conjugacy classes of discrete subgroup of PSL2R. And three-dimensional hyperbolic manifold of finite volume are in one-to-one correspondence with lattices or conjugacy classes of lattices in SL2R. Only okay, I should say, to be precise, I should not say manifold but an O before, but at some point we will get to that also. But anyhow,
is the hyperbolic plane a sub-manifold of the hyperbolic space?
Yes,
sure. You're busy.
It's important there, there's a light code, which is related to physics. All this sits in the light code.
So if you have the X, if we take the upper half space model, for instance, forget the hyperbolic model, then you see that if you restrict to the Y, the axis or the x, the axis, you get that point.
Maybe we can stop whatever you. Maybe you give a little more. No.
No, because I have other plans. But we will discuss it at some point. More interestingly, in some sense, if you look at the level one and look at the plan which sits here on level one. So if you remember the metric, so you divide by the height one, so you got just intrinsically isometric to the hyperbolic, to the real Euclidean plane. So inside the hyperbolic three-dimensional space, I can embed the Euclidean plane. But this embedding is a bit recessive. So it's true that if I want to go from a point here to a point here inside the plane, the distance will be exactly like in the Euclidean plane. But in the hyperbolic space, there is a shorter way. So it's not totally geodesic, it's somehow bent inside. Okay.
So it's not the Riemannian isometry or embedding?
No, it's intrinsically, it's isometric to a hyperbolic plane. If you forget the rest, then it's that ball, it's the Euclidean plane. But if you anyhow,
so
it's similar.
It is a Riemannian isometry, but it is not an isometry. If you know the difference,
let's leave this for later. I just mentioned that these groups are very natural in geometry. we'll get to another point. I mean, we pass through many, many things. We, if we're not focused, we'll not get anywhere, which is also good. But but I'm trying to get somewhere. So, here is a classical theorem called Borel NCT. It's S of C. NCT theorem. It says that if G is a simple group, so as I said, G is a simple group, if H is a cofinite subgroup, then you have two things. H is, let's say, proper. Okay, let's say it's where H is either equal to G or discrete. So if H is proper, then it must be discrete. And the second thing is that always, actually, simple. I also want to assume that it's non-compact. So if a, it's so it's a, so it's discrete and Zariski tense. Okay, maybe just say this way. A proper, if H is a proper, so it's not all G, cofinite subgroup, then H is one discrete, two Zariski tense. Let me say two words about the Zariski topology. Zariski topology is a topology used in algebraic geometry. These groups, SL2, okay, not, let's say we consider SL2R, SL2C, they also can be considered as algebraic groups. And there is a Zariski topology, so these are metric groups. You can look at them polynomial in the matrix coefficient, and this defines the closed set with respect to the Zariski topology. So the Zariski topology is less sensitive. So it's non, it's for instance not Hausdorff topology, and as Uri mentioned, it's not a group topology. But you can consider the same creature that we consider as Lie group, you can consider them as algebraic group. And then there is a Zariski topology. So maybe that's another way that hints the importance of this object. If you come from Riemannian geometry and study locally symmetric spaces, you get to this family of group, the semi-simple Lie group. If you come from algebraic group and study the simple groups there, linear algebraic group, you get exactly the same group, but with different topology. So these groups admit the Hausdorff topology and also the Zariski topology. Basically, to say that a subgroup is Zariski dense, it means that if you have some polynomial in the entries of the matrices, the example I gave are matrix groups, polynomial in the entries of the matrices which vanish on H, then it's vanish on G. Or no polynomial which is not trivial on G is not trivial on H. So for instance, in SLN there is the determinant is a polynomial equation, and the determinant minus one is vanish on, that's the definition of SLN. So this will vanish on any Zariski dense subgroup or any subgroup, but that will be somehow the only one in. So subgroup is a rich dense, it means that it's big in some sense. It could be small in another sense. This is the Borel density theorem. And and Borel proved it, I think, in 66 or 67. And he gave a proof. The proof is not so easy to follow. A year later, Fürstenberg gave a very elegant and short proof for this theorem. And if you apply Fürstenberg proof, you see that it works actually for general invariant tandem subgroup. So again, this is a matter for another talk, to explain Borel density theorem for invariant tandem subgroup. But the theorem says the following: Borel density theorem for IRS. So it's also important to know the statement of theorem. And another thing is to know the proof. Both things are important. But it's valuable to understand the statement even if you don't know the proof. And sometimes it's valuable to understand the proof even if you don't know the statement. In many cases, this is the situation. You remember the proof but not the statement, and
Fürstenberg
is 1961. And Borel density for IRSs is the following theorem. So again, G is as follow. An IRS, if mu is an IRS, if mu is, say, an ergodic IRS, you don't really need the ergodic, but let me just be precise. Then if mu is not the Dirac mass on G, then mu is supported on discrete group.
It's still for simple groups.
I assume that's the assumption. This assumption stands.
For so this is like IRS G by G.
What?
So the IRS is IRS G, and G is a simple.
Yeah, but in IRS, it's about IRS in G, and G is a simple group. So it's either the Dirac mass on G. It's not proper in sense, or it's supported on discrete, or on the closure of the discrete set. And two, if mu is not the Dirac mass on the identity, a lattice cannot be the trivial group, but an IRS can be the trivial group. So if it's not, then mu supported on Zariski density. So it gives you a very interesting structure theory, structural results about the IRS of G. And the proof is not much harder. I mean, you have to add a short lemma. Maybe I'll dedicate a talk for that. The proof is actually very similar to the exercise. What it used the exercise that I gave. It was the exercise that in SL2R, the upper triangular matrices does not admit invariant measures. The Borel subgroup of the upper triangular matrices in SL2R is not cofinite. The projective line does not admit invariant measure. So you use this idea or a generalization of this idea and everything follows. it's a really a clever, beautiful proof, and it's clever enough to satisfy to work in a much more general situation. So for today, I present a statement. It's important results. Also, there are several proofs of it, and we will get to the proof. But for now, I'm just telling you the result. So it's a result of lattices. I said the IRSs are the realization of lattices. So we go from lattices and prove something on IRSs, and the proof is not hard. But just believe me that it's not hard. It doesn't mean that I will spend the required 20 minutes to show you that. But it's not.
A question for Hell density, it does not go the other way, right? The Zariski density-discrete subgroup is not necessarily a lattice.
No. The Zariski density-discrete subgroup is usually not a lattice. So, and in many cases, the IRSs are supported on subgroups which are like that, which are discrete, Zariski dense, but not lattice. It's very easy to be Zariski dense in such a group. Yes. Suppose, for instance, look at SL2R. It's a three-dimensional group. If your group is infinite, it already has positive dimension. So its dimension is at least one. But if its dimension is one, it must be abelian group. So it's not abelian and infinite. It already has higher dimension. So it's very easy to be Zariski dense in a sense. Let me say another fact that I will discuss at some point. in many, okay, let's come back to sub G. Now I still think of this G, but in general for sub G, an interesting question. An interesting question you can ask about sub G is the following question. Is G is a point in sub G. Should I do bracket here or
okay.
Or not? I'm confused with the notation. If G is an isolated point, it's sub G.
Put bracket and erase one of the E's.
Yes.
I trust you here, and also the other one. So is it an isolated point? That's a very natural question and useful to know. And the answer is sometimes yes and sometimes no. Here is a... So in my mind, G is simple Lie group for letter application, but let's now forget that it's simple. So example, exercise, a discrete group gamma is isolated in sub gamma, so if G is discrete, the answer if and only if gamma is finitely generated. So this is an exercise. It's finitely generated, it's isolated if it's not. So another exercise or example, R is not isolated in sub R. A group free line you can approximate by discrete group, by a cyclic group with a very small.
We've seen last time that sub R is an interval.
Yes, sub R is an interval, so there are no isolated points at all. But here is a fact that I think it will be nice to discuss at some point. It's known since the 50s of the previous century, at least since then, even though people did not, I don't know if they spoke about sub G then, but for our case, a simple Lie group, if G is a simple Lie group, then G is isolated in sub G.
So why do you need the brackets? Doesn't G belong to sub G?
It's point. You can see this is a point.
But the points are not the subgroups.
I know that if you put one, then you need the bracket.
Yeah. I know, but one you need the bracket?
No, you don't need the bracket.
You don't need it. That's what I thought there, but I...
Okay, so...
The G now you consider as a point, correct?
Okay.
So you can just consider like bracket.
Yes, G itself is set. Yeah, okay.
But there was one more...
Yeah. Okay. 50%.
Okay.
Yeah.
We are even.
Yes. Then G is isolated in sub G. So this is a good information. Why? Because now we look on the Borel density theorem, and we look at the first part of the Borel density theorem. And we have the following corollary. So let's write the definition first, which is just in general. A discrete IRS, an IRS is discrete if a random subgroup is almost surely discrete. Or in a sense, if it's supported on the closure of discrete group. No, it says more than if you take at random a discrete group with probability 1, if you take at random, so we have a probability measure mu on sub G. And if I pick a random element in mu, almost surely it will be discrete. Then I call the IRS discrete.
Sorry, one more question.
Is there any reason you're not writing semi-simple? Or is simple, do you actually need it to be like simple for this Borel density theorem?
Yeah, because you could write semi-simple, as always, but then the statements are slightly more complicated.
Because you
can be, say, discrete in one factor and all the other factor. There are some, yes, you can, everything works for semi-simple, but then the statements are a bit less clean. No, it's just for convenience. Usually, you can write semi-simple, but then statements are a bit harder to follow. Okay. So, And another notation, the set, this will be the set of discrete IRS. And the corollary, it's a corollary of two results. One is the following, let's call it a theorem, it's a very old theorem. And so maybe when a theorem is old, it becomes easier and easier, and so let's call it a proposition. But, there is a short proof for that, that G is isolated in sub G. And since it's isolated, And since we have that, we have this Borel density theorem, so a corollary of Borel density theorem and the proposition is that for such G, simple E group, IRSD G is compact. Why? Because the space of all IRS is compact, if the Lagrange theorem, and I removed an isolated point, it stays compact. So the set of all discrete IRS is compact. Okay, time calls out to finish, but Fed 15 more minutes, I would deduce from the compactness of IRSD by very elementary means an interesting fact, which is called the Kasdan-Margulis theorem, and in particular implies the following corollaries. So let me just give a propaganda for the next, for what I do next week. A corollary of the corollary. Let's say there exists a positive number such that the volume of every complete three-dimensional hyperbolic manifold is at least V. And the three-dimensional just example, you can take two-dimensional, four-dimensional, and also hyperbolic just example. You can take any symmetric space, if you know what it means, or any simple Lie group, and there is a lower bound on the volume of every lattice in a given simple Lie. This is Kasdan-Margulis theorem. We need a break, so let me just tell you why it follows from this. We say that every lattice given IRS. Suppose that I have lattices with smaller and smaller volume. Take a limit of them. So in general, it makes no sense to take limit of lattices, but now I have a compact space, and I can take limits of the corresponding IRSs. So the limit of the corresponding IRSs will be something of zero measure in a sense, or it could not be discrete. But if it's not discrete, it's but this space is compact, so it must be discrete. So I have a limit of things, and it must be discrete. And on the other hand, its volume is its core volume, say, tends to zero. I'm not precise here, so that's impossible. So basically, to make it more precise, so this argument I want to make precise, although I rely on Borel density theorem and this fact that I still didn't prove, but I will prove. But this corollary is just it's a simple corollary of that, and it gives you somehow a very beautiful, I think, information about important objects. So I would need 15 minutes for that, but I will have it next week. So after the break we will have Gil or Uri?
Gil.
Gil will speak about an example of a group, a locally compact group which admits no IRSs at all. except
I advertised myself in like 1 minute. So there was, it was open for a while, whether like people were looking for examples in which there are no IRS, like as Tariq said in the beginning, there are IRS, but only the obvious ones, delta E and delta G. So then, on the beginning, people came out with discrete examples, but then it was still open whether there are non-discrete such examples. So I'm gonna show a construction, like a very recent construction. I think it's like 2 months ago, something like that. Very recent result of a group with no IRS, which is not discrete.
Yeah, a few years ago, I wrote a lecture note about IRSs, and one of the questions that I posed is to give an example of a group with no IRSs. So, discrete group, there are many examples, like you can show that PSL2Q, or there's something called the Munster groups. There are many examples of discrete group with no IRSs, but there was question whether there is no discrete group, and in particular, it has to be a simple group, because it doesn't have no sound, it has to be a simple group with no lattices. This is already something which is not trivial to construct. And recently, Labodek and Matebon constructed such an example of a locally compact group which is non-discrete and has no IRSs. The disadvantage of their example is that it's still it's a huge group in the sense that it's not compactly generated. So it's still open, it's still, okay, at some point someone will find, but to find a compactly generated, locally compact group with no IRS. So, okay, so this, I think it will be, in some sense, the next talk will be more coherent and elementary,
but not very elementary, maybe, but...
Okay.
Ah, the next, your next. No, you next.
I
will try to make...
Okay, let's meet in 2:15.
Yeah,
no.
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 No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No. No